Good evening. It's February 4th of 2014, and we're here for our first regularly scheduled Select Board meeting of this month. We know that the meeting has been officially warned because we previously went into executive session. The first item on the agenda tonight is to approve the minutes from January 21 and January 29 of 2014. Do we have a motion?
So moved.
We have a motion to approve the minutes from January 21 and January 29, 2014. Is there anybody on the board or anybody who's in attendance who's got any comments or suggestions or anything to say about those minutes or about that motion? Hearing none, all those in favor of approving the minutes from January 21 and January 29, 2014 as presented, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anybody opposed or abstaining? That carries 5-0. The next matter on the agenda is chair's remarks. Well, with the completion of our development of the budget and our approval last week of the warning for town meeting, we now continue forward with the rest of the work of the town over the course of the next months. We are excited tonight to have new police officers here with us to be sworn in, and we'll look forward to that happening here at the Select Board meeting. We will be scheduling also at the end of this meeting another special meeting in order to approve and consider the utilities budget. Another part of what the Select Board has to do is consider utility rates going forward, and as part of the wastewater treatment plant renovations, there's been ordinance in place about utility rates, and that's something that's going to be reconsidered this year. The deadline for candidates to put in their names for townwide offices passed last week, and at least as of last Monday, there were no contested elections for Select Board and for most other town offices. So unless something changes, we will look forward to having this same board working together next year. I think it's been a very productive year that we've had, and we've got a lot of unfinished business that we want to continue forward with, looking at various ways that we can deal with the financial pressures that are facing us. And at least speaking for myself, I can say that I look forward to continuing to working with everybody who's on the board here and with everybody who works for the town. It's also going to be good to see the first renderings from the architect, and talking with our town representative about the police fire facility. There's been a lot of work that's gone on behind the scenes, and that's an agenda item that we're also going to be covering later in this meeting. So we'll look forward to our work going forward. Next on the agenda is town manager's comments.
I have no comments.
All right, and then the next matter on the agenda is Select Board comments and committee reports. Anybody from the Select Board?
I'm excited too, David, about this year. No, I have nothing. There was no committees on my end.
All right, anybody else?
No, I'm fine.
Aren't you excited about next year?
Well, all right. Get to keep working with you, absolutely.
There you go.
I would say the traffic safety met last week, and we continue to address concerns that people bring to the town about traffic-related issues. I think that we adopted a policy over the course of the last couple of months, a traffic calming procedure, and we have started to see people bringing their concerns through that procedure, and we're working out the kinks in terms of people presenting their issues and then making sure that the town gathers information over the course of the time after the concerns are expressed. We encourage everybody to continue participating in that process. The next matter on the agenda is public participation. Is there anybody who's here today to speak to something that's not on the agenda? Now would be a good time. Well then, the next matter on the agenda is liquor commissioners. Do we have a motion to convene as liquor commissioners?
So moved.
We have motion convened as liquor commissioners. Is there any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anybody opposed or abstaining? That carries 5-0. And the first matter on the agenda on the liquor commissioners is an application from Hannaford's. Patrick?
Yes, sir. The board is asked to approve a second-class liquor and tobacco license for Martin's Foods of South Burlington LLC doing business as Hannaford Supermarket. The need for this new license arises from the fact that they've changed their structure from a corporation to a limited liability corporation, and the business has no outstanding fees or taxes, and they do possess a current business license. So we would ask the board to go ahead and approve this.
Does anybody have any questions for Patrick or, I see Annette's here, so anybody have any questions for Patrick or Annette or Chief's here? Any questions about this application? Well, then we're ready for a motion. And that's anybody who's in attendance or anybody on the board? Guess not. All right, motion.
I'll do it. I move to approve a second-class liquor and tobacco license for Martin's Foods of South Burlington LLC doing business as Hannaford Supermarket located at 896 Putney Road.
Is there any further discussion about that motion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anybody opposed or abstaining? That carries 5-0. And then the next matter on the agenda for liquor commissioners is a request for first-class liquor license from Northside Subs. Is there somebody from Northside Subs here? You want to come on up?
Do I have to?
You don't have to, but it's a chance for you to talk about your new business.
Yeah.
It's a free publicity.
Do some promotion.
You know?
We're very
up to the table here.
Right here.
Get your own table.
Make yourself at home.
And I'm going to speak first about it because I had a sandwich there today and it was fantastic. So
you're welcome.
So maybe you'd just like to tell us about your business and tell us your name.
My name's Dorothy Pond, and I opened up last Monday at Northside Subs, a former D'Angelo's on Putney Road. And I'm trying to change it a little bit. So we're doing the original soup sandwich, things like that, you know, salads. But I also have added comfort foods, and I would like to add a beer and wine license. I've built a counter there and just trying to change it a little. I don't want it to be a bar, you know, and I just think that it's nice. I like, if I go for a sandwich and stuff, I like, if I want to have a beer, I want to have a beer. So I would like people in this area to be able to come in. And I work with a friend of mine who is my cook, Michael Klass, and he's friends with, I think it's Bill Manch.
Yep.
That is the, and he's been in contact with him, and Bill, within the next 2 weeks, I guess, is going to do a class that we have to have. So I'm trying to get it, for February vacation during that time.
Excellent.
And that's about it. And we have great food, and everybody should come try it.
Patrick, you want to just speak briefly about the first-class liquor license?
The board is asked to approve a first-class liquor license, so that's the serving of beer and wine, et cetera, at Northside Subs and More. They are in possession of current business license, and they have no outstanding fees or taxes. They've been reviewed and approved by the Brattleboro Police Department, and I believe they've fully obtained a certificate of occupancy with the fire department, so they're good to go.
Excellent. There were some procedures that we adopted last year or the year before that about liquor licenses. Those have been taken care of?
Yes, sir.
Excellent. All right. Are there any Wait. Any questions from anybody on the board or anybody who's in attendance? So I guess we're ready for a motion.
To approve a first-class liquor license for Dorothy Pond, DBA Northside Subs and More, located at 648 Putney Road.
Is there any further discussion about that motion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anybody opposed or abstaining? That carries 5-0. Good luck, Dorothy.
Thank you.
Excellent. Thanks for coming.
Thanks.
I guess we're ready for a motion to adjourn as liquor commissioners.
So moved.
We have a motion to adjourn as liquor commissioners. Yes. Is there any discussion? Here and then, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anybody opposed or abstaining? That carries 5-0. I think we're going to have to schedule a special meeting to discuss the utility budget, utility rates, and the utility capital plan. But what I'd prefer to do is to leave that till the end of the meeting, if that's possible. So we'll just take that up at the end, and we'll change the agenda.
We don't want the officers to sit through that?
No. And so the next item on the agenda is a swearing-in ceremony. So it sounds like I get to call on Annette. Is that fair to say? And Jean, maybe.
I wanted to sit with him.
Okay. You four gentlemen, like, come up. Colby Perlo, Stephen Chase Stanley, Callum Cleary, and Matthew Petlock.
Face your families, please.
Yes.
That's right.
Not us.
Okay. So if the four of you would like to raise your right hand and repeat after me, I can say your name.
And myself as an officer.
To the best of my ability.
To the best of my ability.
So help me God.
So help me God.
And that's it.
Woo! Guys. Tend to drive a little fast on Fairview.
That guy drives a silver truck.
How do you know?
Well, let's see if we can pick our pictures.
Thank you guys for coming. All right. Gene, be nice to him.
So I'd also want to thank Patrick for suggesting that we do this in open public session like this. We've not sworn in our new officers in this way in the past, and I think it's a really good thing. Thank you, Patrick.
Yeah, nice to see Gene in his uniform.
Yep. Thank you. The next matter on the agenda is police fire facilities project update. So Ray and Steve, and I don't know if anybody else is going to come to the table.
This is going to be exciting.
Look at the pretty pictures.
Good evening, everyone.
Hey,
it's magic.
Just a really quick report on the progress of the police and fire projects
team in committee. But before we do that, I want to say thank you for having us. We come tonight to update the select board on the progress that we've made, and to let you know that we have submitted drawings to your planning board to be reviewed for the first time in the upcoming weeks. We thought it would be very important to update you at the same time, so you may have information as well. While Ray is, I guess you're pretty well ready to go, just a few things before Ray puts the boards up and steals the show. We have completed the Phase 2 environmental report for the Donnell property, which is behind Central Station. And Tarragon is the company that did that for us. The verbal response from them is that there has not been any unsuitable or very little unsuitable material or unsuitable discovery in their Phase 2 environmental inspection to lead us to believe that we have any significant problems. That said, what that means to us is that that would allow us to move forward with the purchase and sales agreement on the Donnell property, which still is in motion. We have not received the written report from Tarragon yet, but that is coming any day now. Good news for us. We've also completed the soil testing and analysis of all the three sites just last week. That work is to primarily provide us with soil capacity, bearing capacity. Every building has to sit on something. And also to help us locate ledge and water table at the three sites. Again, we found that there isn't anything in the three sites that would cause us major concern. In fact, the West Brattleboro site has very good soils, and we've discovered that the water table is about 6 feet there, which isn't remarkably deep, but it's deep enough to keep us out of trouble. At the Central Station, we've determined that there is indeed ledge there, which is no surprise to anybody, considering there's ledge in the basement of the existing Central Station. However, what was remarkable was just a few feet away from Central Station, the ledge is found to be 19 feet deep there. So it's interesting topography. We did find a little bit of water at the Central Station Donnell property location, but it is significantly deeper than we anticipated, and again, doesn't seem to be of any concern for future construction there. Lastly, at the police station and municipal building here at 230 Main, we had a requirement of boring for 90 feet deep because we're a critical operations facility here at 230 Main Street. We drilled the 97 feet and never found ledge, even though there's ledge outcroppings in front of the building. So somebody is on our side all the way here on all three properties is the good news. So, and then lastly, we have received an estimate from our construction manager, DEW, indicating that the plans that Ray will be showing us shortly, plans in 3D, I think you brought your 3D, are all within reasonable proximity of our budget. And why I say that is it's a work in progress. We have an $11.2 million construction budget for the three projects. We're hoovering right in that $11.2 million estimate from DEW. So again, good work from the study folks that did the estimate for us before, and good work from our architect who's tracking and keeping our projects within that budget range. So, all good news so far. Questions for me before we turn it over to Ray?
Thanks, Steve.
Just a quickie.
Sure.
When do you anticipate asking for bids?
We are shooting for a May release of final documents. It depends on planning board somewhat. We're subject to their review and comment. We have had an initial conversation with them about certain things, which Ray may or may not update you on that tonight. But all things holding true, we expect to go out to bid in May.
Excellent.
Good. All set, Ray?
Okay. Good evening, everybody. I'm Ray Garrido, Northeast Collaborative. I'll start with Station 2 in West Brattleboro. The plans are in black and white. You're probably more interested in seeing what it's going to look like, I would imagine, but I will go through them briefly. What we're building on is a parcel that we found is really part of the town lease, if you will, to the fire department. This is the existing station here, so essentially to the northeast of it. We've got our new building of about 4,300 square feet, three bays, administrative area, and the quarters area in the back. We have floor plan. It's pretty straightforward. We have, again, our three By the way, the site is that way to build. I've got to turn the building this way. I won't fit on the drawings. So we have our three apparatus bays. There's a main entrance here. There's also a door at, outside the first bay for decontamination. If a firefighter is contaminated, they can enter the building, get cleaned before they actually come into the building. Lobby and office watch area, kitchen, dining, training room, and two bunk rooms. Toilet, of course, turnout gear, gear and extractor, washer dryer area, a shop, and then above this is a mezzanine that we'll have a mechanical room and some storage because the floor to ceiling height is 20 feet so that trucks can be maintained, cabs can be raised, etc. Ooh, Johnny Carson. Jimmy Fallon, I guess, is what it is, not Johnny Carson. I'm dating myself. In elevation, let me see. I'm sorry.
Hey, Ray.
Yes.
Just so you know, I included for the board a copy of
The plans?
Drawing 201 and also A900 for each site. So.
Oh, okay, good. All right. So then you all have seen these. These are the first time you've maybe seen them in color. This is the all four elevations of Station 2 in 3D. We've got the front of the building, essentially a view from the northwest. This is our main entrance here, three apparatus bay doors. You can see the height that allows us to get the mezzanine in the back, and then the quarters area, bunk room, etc., is around back. Leaving room for future expansion either across or extending the bay. So we've done it so that you have some options if the need arises in the future to expand Station 2.
Can I ask a question before you move
Certainly,
on?
Certainly, yes. Yes, we could do that.
The materials that this building would be constructed out of,
yes.
I recall that there was a question whether it was going to be masonry or some other material. Can you speak to that?
Certainly. The entire building will be wood frame. We are able to do wood frame and still provide the seismic bracing that's required. We're going to have a little bit of seal around the center door just to make sure we've got lateral bracing. Prefabricated wood trusses, a very simple roof. You can see it's relatively simple. We might have some stick-built area here, but essentially pretty simple. The exterior is hardy plank siding and PVC trim, essentially maintenance-free. Architectural shingles, decent quality overhead doors. And
so it's going to fit into the neighborhood.
I think it will. I'm hopeful.
That's what you're shooting for.
Yep.
That's the plan.
That's the plan.
Now,
and
looks
we'll
nice.
Use this is fake. It adds a nice element to the building.
That was called
decorative. Thank you, Patrick. I call an architectural ooh ah. Anything else about Station 2?
That's great.
Okay, thank you.
Good luck.
Central Fire Station. I'm pretty sure you all are aware of where the addition is, and it is to the north of the existing station. This is the existing station here, and everything that's a little darker is an addition. So we're essentially occupying the north part of the site, just about to the edge of the Donnell property, slightly over, but this is town-owned land as well. The vehicles will exit to the west, and then go south on Spring Street to Elliott Street. The original four bays, of course, will remain. Smaller vehicles will be in there, and the larger vehicles will be in the new apparatus bays. From a floor plan, we've got, the original four apparatus bays, and we've got all of the vehicles marked here as to what can go where. A new entrance. And you can see on the site plan there's a nice walk coming up to the new entrance with a lobby, elevator and stair to get up to the second level. And then various, this is turnout gear. These two bays remain with some storage built in. Again, storage and a new hose tower, which will double as a training tower. And then the new apparatus bay in the back, three bays, a couple of shops and parts areas,
another decontamination process here, similar to Station 2, where a firefighter can enter the decontamination area outside and then clean up and then come out. A couple of offices here, a report room and a watch room. On the second floor, essentially the entire second floor of the existing building will be gutted. Right in this area is where the main meeting space is, and the chief's office and training room is here in the existing building. Now what we have is, as you come off the lobby from the elevator or stair, you can go right into the administration area and a few more offices across the hall, and then there's a door here to separate the quarters area. So we have bunk rooms around the west and north, and one in the southwest corner, kitchen, living, TV room at the bottom, and then the center core are lockers with each locker room has a shower toilet facility, and then we have additional ones off the corridor that can be for either gender, so that, again, we don't have to have as many toilet facilities and save some money. There is a mezzanine at mid-level of the addition over the few offices of decontamination that you can get to from here, as well as from a stair from down below. And finally, what we call the third floor now is above the new apparatus bay. So when you come off the stairs or the elevator, to the right is Emergency Operations Center. Below that is basically the heart of the facility with the technology data room that'll serve the entire building and the EOC, a large multi-purpose room, training room, and a fitness room with some storage and a small kitchen. The look of the building, let's see. Here we have elevations. This is the elevation from Elliott Street. The existing building is here, and this is the new tower, new host tower. This is the new elevator tower, and the addition sits off in the back here. This is a view from the north with the new host tower. You can see we have a balcony and a door here, because what we'll do is we'll have, as long as we need a host tower, we like to double up its use. So because this is the area where the large vehicles, large apparatuses, they can use the aerial truck, they can use the ladder truck. We put some eye bolts in the wall so firefighters can rappel down, they can rescue off the balcony, they can run hoses up and drop them down. Lots of things you can use that for besides drying hoses and tarps. So that's primarily why it's located in that area. And then a covered area here for the firefighters' use, and probably their major entrance from the parking lot will be there. I'll just go right to the 3D views of this. All right, so this is the view, would be the new view from Elliott Street, where you've got the existing station. The goal is to try to match the brick as much as possible, but then articulate both new towers. This is the new elevator tower, this is the new entrance, and then the other host tower is back here. So we've got the two towers. These are the lobbies on the upper floors that will have a little bit more glass. And then basically you have the large apparatus bay around the back, which is what this looks like. This is the apparatus bay. This would be multi-purpose room, training room. This is the door into decontamination, and then this is the new hose tower. We met with, both police and fire have had groups that have disseminated this information out to what I'll say the rank and file, and have come back to us with ideas. And every project that I do ends up with a really good idea, and one that came on this one is to have an overhead door at the base of the tower, because why have to drag hose or tarps through what we would call a man door or a person door? So that's a really good idea that came out of that, among some others, just reworking the floor plan with this project. So we have an overhead door, so in and out is easy. And you can see that there will be lots of area out here to use that for training, and it's at the back of the building, which I think is great. Any questions about Central? Yes.
I remember there being an elevator, at least a lift, in the plans for the police station. I didn't remember
the elevator for the fire department. So maybe you can speak to why we need an elevator for this facility, number one. Mm-hmm. And then number two, in general, I know there's been some concern expressed or some interest expressed in energy efficiency measures.
Okay.
Maybe you could speak to energy efficiency for the project as a whole.
Sure, I'd be happy to. Let me just find a floor plan. Well, we have areas that need to be accessible beyond the first floor. Every entrance at the first floor level is at grade. However, we have a second floor and a third floor now, and because of accessibility issues, we need to, for example, get anybody that needs to come up to the multipurpose room or the training room to get up there. And the only way you're going to do that is with an elevator, and likewise, second floor as well, because you know we have to think about not only public, which of course would need access to the chief and deputy chief's office and maybe the fire prevention office, but you may end up with a disabled firefighter someday. So you, by law, but also by good practice, you need to make sure you have that accessible. With respect to energy for all three projects, we do have the Vermont Energy Code, which we are obviously have to conform with. In the process, we are going to look at doing a base plan to meet the energy code and then look at, with the construction manager, what would the cost be, for example, to bring the roof from an R30 to an R60? What's the cost? What may need to happen over the existing station, for example? Can the roof accommodate the additional load of the insulation and the additional snow load that may happen because of it? Look at the cost for that, then do an energy analysis. How much will we save? And then look at the numbers. We'll do the same thing with the walls. We'll do that in all three facilities. From a mechanical perspective, each of the buildings will use energy recovery, which is a good way of harvesting energy from heat that's in the building, reheat or preheat the air that's being forced into the building with what's in there already, so that you don't have to heat the air as much, spend as much energy to heat the air. In each of the fire stations, the floor of the apparatus, the new apparatus bays, will be a radiant slab. Very low temperature. Once the concrete mass heats up, you're looking at probably 100 degrees at the most with the water temperature going through that. And the recovery is very quick once the doors drop down, the recovery of that, because you have such a large slab radiating heat, and it also dries the floor. I mean, you sort of get that benefit out of it. We're looking at all of that. We do the base plan, and then we look at alternatives. Did you want to add anything? Okay. Anything else?
Yeah. What's the old apparatus base?
Yes.
What will they be used for?
More apparatus. We're using part of the old apparatus bay for turnout gear. I like to think of the process of the firefighter. Let's say the firefighter's in the kitchen or they're sleeping. The alarm system now has soft wake up. So the lights come on gradually, the alarm is softer and it gets louder and louder. The whole heart attack issue, you know, quick start wake up. They come down this stair, typically, that's where they're going to come down, and then they've got to go in both directions. Because we're using the smaller vehicles in the old apparatus bay, we've got 45 turnout gear, what they call gear grid. They're open grid with all the turnout gear here. So a firefighter can come in, exit this way, come in, exit that way, exit this way. So it's right at the bottom of the stairs, gear up, and they're out. So that seemed like the most logical place to put it, rather than the back wall here or the side wall over here when they've got to go in two directions. So we're using that. We're taking up a fairly sizable amount of space of that for that.
Where does the smaller apparatus go? Where does it go now?
It's all squeezed in there, pretty much, right?
Yeah, it's either behind the bigger stuff or it's outside.
Yeah.
this plan, all the small stuff will go into
Right. What I'm wondering about is lighting, LED, and fluorescent.
Big new apparatus bay is getting built, and I wonder if it wouldn't be possible to take the things that are on the third floor and put them in the old apparatus bay and not build the third floor and save a significant amount of money doing that.
I think we need them for vehicles. Based on the inventory, we need them for vehicles.
The apparatus space is about to be doubled. And it's, how can that be?
Well, I mean, the other thing you need to think about, for example, at West Brattleboro Station 2, in the future plan is what's called a quint. It does five different operations. Saves you a lot of money because you only need to buy one piece of apparatus to do five operations. I probably could say them off the top of my head, but I probably will forget one. But it's a longer piece of apparatus. So there may be a piece here, for example, that in the future might be 8 or 10 feet longer. So, you have to think, you can't squeeze yourself down so much that you don't want to have a little bit of room.
Well, that's part of why we have to build the trucks are bigger now. They have
right, and with this, with the existing apparatus bay, the floor to ceiling is so short, you've had to have custom vehicles manufactured just to fit through the door, and they just make it, which is why the larger ones that are in here now will go back here. We have 14-foot high doors now, so the next one you buy will be sort of off the shelf, and you won't have to pay such a premium. Yes.
Can you speak briefly to what the decontamination area consists of and any special considerations in constructing that?
Well, it's all hard surface, able to be washed down. If somebody is out on a call and blood or all kinds of things that could happen, mud. Who knows what could contaminate hazardous material if there's a something like that. The firefighter or EMT or whomever can come into this room, which is the first space is the decontamination room. Huge sink, spray, all kinds of, leave your gear there, strip down, get clean. Then you go into the clean room where you can shower. Generally, there's a cabinet in there with a hospital gown. There's a toilet and a sink. You get cleaned up, put the hospital gown on, and you go upstairs to your bunk, get a new set of clothes. So, and then the decontamination room, somebody can suit up and go spray it down and clean it. So it's all hard surface, floor drains, and it's relatively easy construction because it's concrete and concrete block and epoxy paint. But the plumbing is really the biggest thing.
So that has its own holding tank and its own plumbing for the contamination?
That's a good question, John. I think if it was something like hazardous material or hazardous waste, I think we would probably need to do something else before going here. Yeah, I might have, misspoke on hazardous waste, but probably anything that could go down into the sanitary sewer. If it's something more hazardous than that, they'd have to go somewhere, for decontamination. The other thing Steve just reminded me is we are looking at using LED lighting as much as we can in here. With a 24/7 facility, when you look at the cost benefit of LEDs versus fluorescent, if there's an upcharge, sometimes there are grants available. The local utility has specific lighting products, and your local utility has a really good list. Some utilities offer us like four. This utility has a very good list. Our engineer's looking at it, and then they'll give you a rebate for buying it, and then on top of it, you will save. You can do a 40 watt bulb with a 2 watt LED or something. So it's great, and they're looking better. The light output is a lot warmer than say these fluorescents. So. It's here, yes.
I wanted to follow up on Dave's inquiry about the third floor in the back and the new part of the facility. Can you speak a little bit about the EOC and what's going to be located there and how that's designed?
We don't have that completely detailed yet as far as the equipment that is going to go in there. We do know that the data room here is basically going to be a bunker, because that, as I said, that's the heart of the facility. We are required by the fire code to single out specific equipment that they call critical operations for critical operations power system. It's called COPS. So we're in the process of identifying that. I'm waiting for a response from the Division of Building and Fire Safety in Springfield to help us, because it's the local authority having jurisdiction, which in this case is them, to get back with us, and we can talk about what really are the systems that they're concerned about. Then we'll meet with the chief, we'll meet with the police chief as well, and figure out what pieces do we really need to have that critical operations power systems.
We now do EOC operations out of
the basement.
Out of the basement, sometimes out of a truck, or was that? That's the command post.
Our plan at this point is to essentially provide power and data around the entire room. You'll have tables, chairs. You'll be able to do computer hookups. You'll be able to do video. You'll have all of the dispatch connections and such, so that it will be the secure room to go to. And I would submit that I would never want to see that on the first floor, especially since this building is going to be braced so it'll withstand seismic event. It will, and having it up rather than at grade, any water issues. So it's the right place for it up on the third floor, certainly.
Excellent.
I'd be happy to show the board the existing EOC at this point, if anyone was interested in seeing it.
It's pretty.
It's worthy of some
It's worthy of looking at.
All right. Thank you.
You're welcome. Good.
Before we move on to to the police, might it make sense, Mike, for you to say a couple of words? Obviously, you've been involved with the development of these plans, and are you comfortable with them? Is there anything you would like the board or the public to know that you see?
Want this, Mike? Oh. Anything else?
We've worked very close with Stephen Wright. We also have a group of five employee group that represents all of them. Who we've worked very closely with, they connected these folks. We're at this point very happy. We think it's come along very well. Everything that we need now and into the foreseeable future, I think, is in both stations. We've made some minor tweaks, and I think there'll be some more coming. Ray and I were just talking earlier about a couple of different changes that we're going to look into, but overall, we think the two fire stations have come along great.
These will be in use for generations, given our practice.
Many years to come.
These are
will outlive my employment here.
Oh, no. Stop.
Can you say here that those facilities would serve both the fire department and the public well for the expected period of time in which they'd be in use?
I feel very comfortable saying that. They'll carry this municipality well in the future.
I just want to make sure that I said this. The entire addition is masonry. So we have on the ground floor we have concrete block backup, brick veneer. The towers are a colored concrete block unit with backup as well. The existing building has two different types of brick. When the addition was done, the match was so-so. What we're going to try to do is match the original. We're not suggesting that we replace the brick on the addition. It's probably close in color, but the texture of it is different. But we'll just let that be, and we'll always know that was the first addition, and this is the second addition.
It'll fade all together.
It'll hopefully all blend together. Yeah. Okay? Yep. Great. Thank you so much. Next is police. The police facility, I will say, was the most difficult to come to a plan that works. Let me just start. Very early on, when we looked at this project, we had some concerns about how much of the police program would be in Town Hall, because the police and fire both are considered essential facilities. I'm sorry, lost that one.
I could have told you that.
I know. Essential facilities, which
you
means...
You just let your hand go. I saw that.
Thanks, Steve.
Sorry.
Is it okay to be embarrassed on TV?
Yeah, you don't have to be embarrassed.
Essential facility means that it's 24/7 operation, it's public safety, and what the building code requires is an upgraded structural system specifically geared towards seismic design, and it's 1.5 times what you would do, say, in a not so much an office building, maybe something a little bit higher than an office building, but a hospital, for example, would be in a similar category. So whatever we would typically do, let's just say for an office building, 1.5 times as complicated or as strong. And so what happens is whatever is being used for what we would call the essential parts of the police facility has to be able to stand up if the town hall falls down, to put it pretty plainly. So as part of that, the foundation system for the addition needs to be very strong and complicated. And the foundation for this building is stone. So if we were to do a basement, for example, we have to dig down, we have to shore up, we have to hold up that stone while we dig this big hole. Then somehow we have to brace that stone, pour the new foundation, make sure that whatever the foundation load is, that doesn't then press against the foundation of the town hall, and push it in. So that was the first thing. We thought, geez, the basement is going to be really difficult to do and expensive, and there's not a lot of room here to dig a big hole. So my first thought was, let's see if we can do this without a basement. It's going to increase the footprint a little bit, but let's see if we can do it without a basement. Then the issue was, okay, what can we put into Town Hall that we could say is not essential? I know Gene may not like this, but his office will be in Town Hall. He and Gunny, the administrative offices, essentially, on the second floor with records and some storage. On the lower floor will be the locker rooms for the police officers. Everything else, I would consider the patrol area. I would consider roll call, definitely the booking area, definitely the cells, the sally port, definitely dispatch, detectives, obviously the IT, the heart of the facility. All of that needs to be in the addition. Make a long story short, it did increase the footprint a bit, but the overall square footage is essentially the same, and we're able to do it without a basement. The impact on the site, however, is that the building comes out a little bit more to the west and a little bit more to the south. The other thing I wanted to make sure of is that there was reasonable access to the sally port, and that the sally port was big enough. The study showed the sally port on the south, and from my experience, it was too short, and we don't like to have officers, when they're in the sally port, if they get a call, to be restricted as they're backing out. If you got to respond, you got to respond, and you have to have enough room to do it. So we then decided to place the sally port on the west, so that they've got enough room to back out and go in either direction, and off they go to the call. And as you'll see in the elevations, the second floor is smaller than the first floor. So I'll show you that, but my thinking is we've got the historic town hall. It's on the National Register. The Department of Interior says whatever we do to touch this building, we have to be able to uncover it in the future. That's the requirement. So wherever we are blocking up windows, for example, we're not taking the windows out. We're doing a partition on one side and a partition in the addition on the other side, so the window stays. the trim stays, the brick stays, the head above the window.
It's just to hold the building together.
That's true. So we have to be very careful. And, you know, what we're asking, or what you're asking me to do, is to design a secure facility, which has its own issues, windows, garage, and the whole seismic thing, against a historic structure. So I want to be able to at least see all the cornice detail work and make sure that we stay away from it, we don't touch it. And we're going to have a 4-inch joint between the addition and the new building, so that, again, if there's ever any rumble.
Addition and old building, right?
Addition what?
In old building, not new building.
Oh, I'm sorry, old building. The addition and the existing building. Thank you. So, let me just take you briefly through the plan, then, because there are some interesting things that are happening. What's going to happen now, this is the rear entrance to Town Hall on the west side. Because of the police addition, which is all in white, the new entrance to the back of Town Hall will be on the north side, which in many respects, because of the fact that the building is moving west, the parking lot is up here, police vehicles will be close to the building, and the other parking is along the north, it kind of makes sense that people are going to be coming in this direction to get to Town Hall. They will come in this direction to get to police as well. So we will create a new entry lobby. This way you get into Town Hall. This way you get into police. Town Hall can get locked up. Police is 24/7. They're now separated with a common lobby. Right off the lobby is dispatch, which serves the public as well, as you know. And there is a waiting area inside the police entrance. There is an interview room. The interview room, as you can see, has two doors. One is on the secure side, one is on the non-secure side. Somebody's running into the police station and off the street because something's going on. They can come in this room, lock themselves in, camera, somebody's alerted, an officer can come in from the other side, take care of whatever needs to happen. That's a very important interview room. There's also a public toilet off the waiting area. Once you're past this line, you're all secure. So on the east side are all the patrol stations, sergeant, lieutenant, work room, break room. There's a stair here to go up. There's an entrance here for police to come in. The roll call room is right here. When you win the roll call, out to the vehicles. Roll call has a back entrance to the cell block. Sally Port is here. Officer comes in, the prisoner comes into the booking area. There's a decontamination, there's a shower, and then four cells and a DUI cell. So it's relatively compact. One of the things that we were able to do is the circulation is really tight, which allowed us to get the keep the square footage down as much as possible. There is, as the chair mentioned, there is a lift here. And with this stair, you go up a half a flight. To what would be the first floor of Town Hall. This is where the patrol officers are now. So you come up the stair, you come up the lift, and we've got a women's locker room and a men's locker room, and then an exit here to get to another egress stair in Town Hall. So locker rooms are here, half a flight up from what you just saw. You go up one more flight. We're using the Town Hall elevator, which is here, that you can get off the elevator should there be a disabled officer to get to the locker room. So we're not doing a new elevator in the addition. We've been able to solve this problem without a new elevator. Across from the locker rooms, the police are vacating the north side here, which is where the administration is and roll call. and planning department will move down there because the police will be taking over planning, which is above here, which I'll show you next. So we've met with Rod Francis and his team. They fit very well, the new conference room for them, all their files fit in there, so they will move down from up on the second floor, which I think also will hopefully create some efficiencies with public access to planning. So this is the second floor. The addition is here, and this is the existing town hall, all at the same level. When you get off the elevator and you come through this door, there's a training room. We have an opening down to the lobby below. And then we've got all of the detective functions here, forensic investigations, and also evidence in the middle, which doesn't need windows. So there is an evidence drop, evidence lockers, the evidence officer. There's a process for evidence which the police don't have now, where an officer comes in, tags it, puts it in a locker, drops a key in a box. The evidence officer, then only him or her, comes in, goes behind, retrieves it, processes it, and then stores it, so that there's that separation. Off to this side, we've got weapons cleaning, armory, storage, range equipment, a fitness room, which again, you know, that's about it's one flight up from the locker rooms. This is the IT closet, data area, and then this would be administration with chief, deputy chief, administrative assistant, conference room, and then storage and records. With records, we've split the staff. There are two staff. One would be able to serve officers that need to get records, and then off the town hall corridor, a person can come in to a window here and ask for records. Right now, I believe that has to function through dispatch. What we're doing now is, again, much more efficient. The records clerk will be able to go up to the window, find out what they need, and take care of it that way. So for the look of the building, let's see. Here is the north elevation. I think you all know where the fire escape is. So this would, right about here, would be the parking along the north side, along the state office building. The new entrance is here, and as I mentioned, we're under all of this fancy brickwork that goes along the west side as well. We've raised a portion of the building to somewhat be responsive to the eave height of the building, and then it drops down as you get further to the east. So the new entrance is here. There'll be a few parking spaces. There'll be a walk. There'll be crosswalks to get to that. This elevation is the south. The existing emergency generator, for example, is right here. So this would be the patrol area. This is fitness. The IT room is behind that. We've got roll call and administrative, roll call and detectives here. And then this is the cell block. The Sally Court, which is west, the double Sally Port, we are going to have some built-in signage, and that will recess some brickwork and have signage to direct people. When you come in, you're going to be kind of facing this library, town hall, police, around the corner, that sort of thing. But we want to make sure it doesn't end up being something that's stuck up with bubble gum. We want to make sure there's a place for it, and we'll design that signage. Likewise, we'll have a monument sign on the other side, actually right here, that will direct people around the corner so that they know where the entrance is. And up here, this is where it sets back. The perspectives of that, the 3D, this is all brick too, by the way. So the 3D, as it's being developed now, this is the new entrance. This is a two-story space that you can, you know, at least have a little bit of grandeur as you come in. And then again, you go up, you go to the left of town hall and straight ahead to police. So we've got, as you can see, this is the training room, conference area, and then it steps down. And you can see that we've respected the town hall. We do have some brick corbelling just to be a little bit sympathetic to what the historic structure is without spending too much of the town's money. And this would be just be a south elevation, or the south perspective, so town hall in the back and then the building wrapping around. So, questions?
Anybody? So, Ray, could you go back to the parking, where all the parking is?
Site plan? Sure. One thing I might say, John, the comments we've had so far are predominantly about this site.
Yes.
And in a nutshell, the comment is, site's been bad for a long time. Do you think you can do something with it? So, you ask your question, and then I'll tell you where we are.
That's kind of where I was going with it.
This is in its infancy.
I know.
This is not where it is today, as of right now. Okay.
The first thing I want to say is that the Oversight Committee, and with the chiefs and everybody involved, I think have done a fantastic job. I mean, I don't know if you guys have worked with a lot of committees before, but just being kind of an outsider, I'm not a voting man, I'm just there for the select board, I think they've raised a lot of good questions, and they're...
Yes.
Keeping everybody in check on the finances and stuff. But I do know that one of the concerns was because the footprint is a little bit bigger now, that we're going to be losing some parking. And then how the traffic is going to come off of Grove Street and in, and then we had talked about, could maybe explain how, because right now a lot of the people are down use it as a cut-through.
Right, yeah. Right.
And now because the Sallyport's going there, I just want people to be aware of, and we can always take from eminent domain, there's a whole lot of land from the O'Connors that we could use for parking. But explain that.
Okay. Let me just start with...
it's not etched in stone yet.
Right. Even as of noon today, the site planner and I exchanged some sketches about this. The study... eliminated 30 spaces. This plan as it stands right now in front of you, we eliminated 34. So, you know, we're pretty close even with the expanded footprint. I do know that you got about 20 spaces back from the state, so that they're not going to use. So these spaces back here are back in use. However, the study basically left the site the way you see it here, and you're right, it's not great. It's not great with the Sallyport down here or here, because you've got police vehicles trying to cross in front of pedestrians trying to get to the building and all of that. What we're looking at, and it's going to mean probably losing about another 10 spaces, but we have to respond to the planning board and then see maybe we come up with some compromise. What we're looking at doing is keeping this entrance two ways for police only, potentially. It isn't, there is enough room here two ways for any traffic, but the potential is we could make it two ways only for police and one way for the public, and force everyone to take a left.
Yeah.
Eliminate this sort of convoluted parking and create an island with parking on one side that needs to be reserved for police vehicles, potentially either there or coming in this direction, and create site circulation that comes around and out, and have a sign here, but narrow this down, create a crosswalk, and allow only police vehicles to pass through there. It allows an officer, because the island will come down far enough, not to interfere with cars coming in and turning left, back up and go out this way, back up and go out that way, and the only place that they would really interfere with cars exiting is right there. That's the plan, and then we end up with a crosswalk so that somebody parking out here can get onto the island with a walkway, come across, get to the main entrance, do a crosswalk here, possibly with a speed bump. They're just really, and to eliminate that really quick cut through, if somebody wants to cut through, they've got to come in, go all the way around, and come out.
So, Ray, with the driveway as it is right now, it's one way coming in off of, what is that, Main Street?
One-way going out to Main Street.
So would that still stay one-way?
Oh, yeah. So that's what we're looking at. You know, we also have parking for the library. We have the handicap parking space. There's been some discussion, what do we do for loading space for the library? And I think we've got a solution to propose for that. We need a loading space for Town Hall, which there's plenty of room on this side. We thought about narrowing this down a little bit more just to try to soften that up. But I think let's take care of what we need to do for here. And again, we need to look at budget and make sure we're not, because, you know, whatever we do out here is going to add some cost. But, you know, we'll finesse it and try to make it work. That's the goal. We, as Steve said to the committee last time, we will not present you a project that's over budget, period. Just not going to do it. Yes?
Now in the basement are locker rooms, what passes for exercise space, cells,
yes.
The safe where evidence for long term is sort of stored.
Yes.
What's going to be in the basement going forward?
Long term police storage is going to go where the existing EOC is, and the existing cell block area, which is easily accessible through this stair from the new police area, will be long term evidence storage. The cell block really makes sense because we can keep the cell block doors. Gene's evidence officer can separate evidence as necessary. It's secure. So it really makes sense to put that down there. So we're definitely not going to waste that space, but we don't have to renovate it for anything. We don't have to spend any money on it.
What's going to happen to those beautiful bathrooms that are down there now?
Any other questions or comments from anybody on the board or from anybody who's in attendance, anybody from the press? Thank
you. Yeah, Chief, maybe I think you see where my line of inquiry might be going. You've had a chance to work with these gentlemen on the development of these plans. Do you feel they adequately address some of the problems that the existing layout has? And do you see them as being supportive of the town's police functions for generations to come? As you know, that's how long we'll be using these facilities.
Yeah, the big problems that we identified going through this whole process, this footprint and these plans will solve those problems and will clearly much more efficiently take us into the future. And Ray and Steve have been working hard at all the little problems and trying to fit it into this. There's been many versions of this. So,
six.
Yeah.
At least.
So there's a lot that's being solved in this in these proposed changes. As I'm sure the board will recall, there is a really convoluted mixture of different types of individuals that find themselves out in front of the dispatch window presently. This is providing a safe place for people to go that's going to be out of the direct pathway of the general public. You know, we're pulling the cell block out of the basement. We're getting out of the wet and dingy and somewhat moldy space in the basement. We've added on the Sally Port. This is really solving a lot of problems here at the Municipal Center, and it's a nice solution, particularly given that initially we started this with the idea that there'd be a new basement. So.
Howard.
Can you, does the board have to approve the final design, or what's the procedure to go from here to, you know, sending out the bid?
I think tonight what we're seeking, if Steve, you can jump in and change my direction, but I think tonight what we're seeking is to just bring the board up to date. These are still... Perhaps, Steve, you could talk a little bit about where these are in the overall scale of designs.
Sure.
I seem to recall early on there was a 30% complete, a 50 or a 60, and then on to 100% complete, maybe where we're at and where it would be important for us to get ultimate approval on the plans.
Yes, lots of points there to be answered. The drawing level for West Brattleboro is, well, there's several levels, but schematic design, design development, and then construction documents. Those are the three major categories. And West Brattleboro Station 2 is well beyond schematic design. It's into roughly 40% level completion. And by the end of the month, it'll be 50% complete. Drawings will be 50% complete. Central is slightly behind that, but close to the 40% level mark over schematic design. If I say SD, I mean schematic design. And again, they'll be ready at the end of the month to be at the 50% mark. And the police municipal building has lagged behind because of our difficulties getting the essential facilities into a safe footprint. But we're easily at the schematic design level, which is 30%, moving on to 50%, rapidly catching up by the end of the month. We didn't necessarily, and I mean nothing by this, but we didn't come for approval tonight, but more for information. And I say that only because I think you've delegated to your overview committee or building committee the authority to make those judgments on your behalf, and they have been regularly. We meet regularly. And this Thursday, we'll meet with them again to update them on these drawings, but they are fully informed of the basic footprints already, and now we're fleshing in details. We did want to keep you updated, and if there's any comments or things that you want to share with us, we're more than open to receive those, but to answer the gentleman's question, we didn't come here for that approval necessarily.
But is that approval part of the process? I'm just wondering. I don't know. Does the board have to approve the final design, or does the committee approve it? Do you guys? Just for information, I just wondered how it works.
I think that while the committee has been delegated that authority, I think it would be proper to ask the select board to approve the plans as well.
Is there a particular percentage at which you think that would be most appropriate?
I think most appropriate would be sooner than later. If you have any major objections, now would be the time to speak. But if you don't have major objections to the concept, then we're really going to be looking at the design development level of 60%, which we consider no turning back at that point. And that would be sometime in late March, probably mid to late March, where there'd be no turning back without some serious consequences.
And at this point, you know, based on my experience at the committee level, and anybody chime in, they have approved each of these substantially as presented.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
I think is the terminology.
Yeah.
I think what I would respond to that is the responsibility to finally approve rests with the select board. And I think we've delegated oversight to the police fire committee, but we expect to have regular reviews back here. That's why we have select board representation and not voting membership, but representation on that committee. And I don't think that we'll be going to substantial drawings and final approvals without the select board directly reviewing and ultimately voting on that.
And I think the Oversight Committee is well aware of that.
Yeah.
You know, that they're kind of advisory. And so
I anticipate, based on what I've heard, that sometime in the next 6 to 10 weeks, we'll be hearing from you with much more detailed plans.
Indeed.
For us to approve as a select board before we go out to bid through the construction manager. Mm-hmm.
It would be nice if there were any objections this evening to hear those, if you have any.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And that's why we asked you to come tonight to talk with us about it.
Sure.
I just wanted to point out one other thing which came up the last meeting of the Oversight Committee, is that this design has been looked at a number of different ways, and also there was a lot of consideration of the possibility of putting it in other places as well.
Yeah.
It wasn't just, you know, things haven't just gone along with everything the way it was last March when the town approved that preliminary design. There's been a lot of exploration.
Yes.
Anything you want to add to that, John?
No.
Don't go there.
I have not touched that with a 10-foot pole.
Okay.
No.
Well, I think having it fleshed out is important to the extent that there's been healthy dialogue about where it's going to be and what's going to be in it.
It hasn't been a neat rubber stamp on
it
at all.
It has not. I mean, there's been a lot of things broached and a lot of things, you know, so it's a process.
I think it's fair to say that there are a wide variety of views on the committee.
Yep.
Those views are very capably articulated by differing members. There's been a number of very interesting debates that have gone on again and again, ranging from considerations like should we be working towards maximizing value, as in, you know, what can we accomplish with $14.1 million? Or should we be working towards how do we accomplish what we need to at the lowest possible price? There are differing views on that, and dynamics such as that get brought up and discussed at each and every turn. In addition, you know, some members of the committee have again asked, you know, is this the location that we should be looking at this? This is, of course, the location that was voted on and approved by voters. And so, you know, we will continue to explore any reasonable inquiry at the committee level. And at the same time, slowly make forward progress on the charge that has been handed to us, or has been handed to them.
So in terms of all the plans that were presented, the only real cause for concern that I have has to do with circulation here at the town hall site, mm-hmm. and I'm talking exterior circulation, mm-hmm. because it's problematic now,
right.
and we're going to lose spaces, and I understand that that's not fully developed yet, and you're still considering, and really... circulation for a site plan like this is something that's squarely in the purview of the Development Review Board.
Right.
So it's interesting for us to be talking about it and to hearing the concerns about it, but ultimately they're the body that reviews and approves circulation-related issues with respect to site plans, and there's a separate appeal if somebody's not happy about that, that's not to the Select Board. So
When does that process happen? When will you go before the DRB?
Well, that's why we're here tonight, because
the first
submitted
meeting
plans.
Is the 19th.
Yeah. Because I know it's changed a little bit from when our last meeting, so I'm just wondering.
Yeah, well, the floor plans have been tweaked a little bit, but that's not
right.
As much
but
of a concern.
But that one-way or the two-way, you know, that...
Well, right, we have not... The site plan that we're showing here is what we submitted.
Right.
Right now, we're responding to the first round of comments from town staff,
mm-hmm.
Which are not unanticipated. I mean, we expected to get comments. Our goal is to try to review those, talk with town staff as to do they want us to have some dialogue before the 19th? Do they want us to come prepared on the 19th with some responses? Do we want to wait until to see if the board has any other questions or concerns? But with respect to this particular site, they're major enough that we, as a design team, want to make sure we have had a chance to look at them and come up with some suggestions.
Patrick?
Yes, sir. Ray referenced this a little bit, but I'm not sure if I've ever fully talked it through with the board or the public. In anticipation of the known loss of parking that was going to occur at this site, I recognized at some point in time when they were renovating the state facility that it might be a worthwhile time to consider what had been an agreement we had, a sort of a handshake agreement we had with the state of Vermont for use of, I believe it was about 15 parking spaces in the back of the Municipal Center parking lot. In light of the fact that we recognized, even during the Black River design, that we were going to be losing such a substantial amount of parking, We notified the state of Vermont that we would be having to recapture that parking for our own uses, and we figured as long as they were doing a renovation project and we're no longer using them, might be a good time to let them know. So while we may be losing, I think it's right now roughly 34, that's with having recently gained as many as 15. So
can we, or I guess the question is, how would we designate part of the High Grove lot for permanent parking? Like maybe that first section that's up against the retaining wall there.
Wait. That's very interesting, but we're going to talk about that another time. There's a lot on the agenda.
In terms of this proposal and the number of spaces that might be required, and that was an option for additional employee parking. It's not much further to walk than the corner of that lot.
It's not under my charge, so I don't. Yeah.
Not anybody's.
Right. It's way interesting. We'll ask Patrick to look at it, but we're not going to talk about it anymore tonight because there's no time.
That's it.
Sorry. Any other questions or comments or any other significant issues to relate to the design team, given that we're getting close to the point where major changes would yield major cost ramifications? We're all set? Well, thank you. That was helpful.
Thank you very much.
Way interesting.
Thanks for having us.
Thank you, guys.
The next matter on the agenda is 2014 Certificate of Highway Mileage. And since they're just unpacking over there, Steve and Hannah, if you could speak from the microphone, that'd be nice. Is that okay?
Oh, absolutely.
Thank you.
Let me check with the town manager to make sure he's okay.
I'm here tonight to ask your approval. It's a Certificate of Highway Mileages. And this is a form that goes into the state each February and verifies the number of miles and the classifications of miles of roadway that we have in Brattleboro and are responsible for. We have reviewed this list and we feel it's accurate, so we're asking for your signature and approval. If you have any questions, I'll answer them.
Anybody on the board have any questions about the Certificate of Highway Mileage approval request?
There's no changes?
There's no changes at all this year. There might be in the coming year, but we can add on those roadways at any time.
Thanks.
Any questions from anybody on the board or anybody who's in attendance? Hearing none, we're ready for a motion.
Move we approve the 2014 Certificate of Highway Mileage as presented.
Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anybody opposed or abstaining? That carries 5-0. The next matter on the agenda is the Wastewater Treatment Plant Outfall Pipe Project. Would you like to have a seat? Can you tell us about that?
Okay, there's two remaining projects from Tropical Storm Irene. One is the Cook Road Bridge, and the other one is an outfall pipe at the wastewater treatment plant that was damaged. The outfall pipe is the discharge pipe after the treatment process at the wastewater plant. That goes into the Connecticut River. During the storm, it was discovered that the section of the pipe had broken off. And after an extensive appeal process and quite a bit of effort by a lot of the town staff, we're still pursuing this project. And Hannah will fill you in. We've actually put bids out, and she'll give you the details on the bids.
So in January of 2013, we finally received notification from FEMA that we had won our appeal and this project would be considered eligible for reimbursement. In July, we met with multiple agencies from the state, the Department of Environmental Conservation, Agency of Natural Resources, Vermont Emergency Management, the Wastewater Division to get everybody on the same page and be able to move forward with this project. And we all felt confident that the best way to do this was through the design build process again, that it would expedite the process. And it would ensure that the contractor had an engineer on their team to work with permit compliance issues. There's a lot of permits involved here, being in the Connecticut River. It's a border water, even though we're not actually in the New Hampshire portion of the waterway. So we put this out to bid in the very end of November and beginning of December. We received three bids on time, one from Kingsbury Companies of Waitsfield, Vermont, in the amount of $152,200, a bid from Renault Brothers of Vernon, Vermont, in the amount of $179,888, and one from Bidco Marine out of Buffalo, New York, in the amount of $198,750. All of these bids were substantially more than the amount that FEMA has allotted for this project, which is $76,327. We have submitted a scope change, cost change request through VEM to FEMA, and Vermont Emergency Management is supporting that. And we have not heard back from FEMA on that. We have been advised to move forward with the project without having that approval quite yet from FEMA, because they will see it as not necessary if we're waiting for their approval. And after reviewing the bids, Steve and myself reviewed them, and we feel that Kingsbury Companies submitted a very strong proposal. They gave us a very rapid schedule. They have a lot of experience in wastewater treatment facilities, marine work, and FEMA experience, and they are also the lowest bid.
Is there a reason why there's such a big discrepancy, or is it just?
I think there's a lot of unknowns with this type of project. Originally, we thought that a lot of this work might have been done by underwater divers, for instance, and that seems to, with this group of people that bid on it, they feel that they're going to have to dewater and take, you know, and so everybody has a different opinion on their approach, and that shows in these numbers. But I don't think they're that really far apart when you look at this type of project, because it is a design build. So some people, you know, the engineering may cost more in their eyes and the construction, you know, less, or vice versa. But I mean, 152, 179, that's not too far apart for a project like this.
No, I was wondering from the original.
Oh, from the original. The original,
yeah,
I think,
original.
You know, we see this, and you're going to hear this same story from us, and I'm sure you've read in the newspaper and heard from the media the different challenges that towns have had with bridges.
Right.
You know, a bridge, it's only going to cost $300,000 to replace, and it came out at $800,000.
Right.
So you're gonna hear this again. This is another good example. They have a method in which they determine the replacement value of this pipe, and the pipe is older, and that's the cost that they feel is appropriate. It doesn't always meet what the actual value is, and we saw that with other projects also.
Well, then, to follow up on that, fair to say that the work's got to get done.
The work needs to be done, for sure.
So even if we didn't get the grant?
We have to pay the rest ourselves.
Even if we didn't get it, we would still be looking to do this project anyway.
That's right.
Not just looking, having.
Having to do
the project.
Yeah, we have to do it.
Because
right.
It's federally mandated?
It's our main discharge pipe into the Connecticut River, and
that
piping needs to be in place.
Yep.
And it was, you know, the very end of the piping was destroyed during Irene, so...
Yeah.
We have an obligation to fix that. That's part of the original design, the original permit from the wastewater treatment plant.
Well, it's been nice to get good reimbursement from FEMA over the course of the last 2 years,
yeah.
But, you know, we've got to go ahead and do this. So
Maybe they'll kick in some more money.
I'm optimistic. I mean,
yeah.
Hannah and I met with the officials, and we traveled to go meet with everybody, and we came up with a strategy, and they supported it. They also said that we think you need to move forward these bids.
Yep.
That shows that you need this to be completed. And behind all that, we're going to work for the town to see what we can do to bring additional funding.
If we don't get additional funding, this is going to be an off-budget item that we're going to have to come up with money for?
This would be something that I would be looking at out of the utilities fund and water and sewer. Out of capital, I would expect that we would... look at some of the projects there and try to do a transfer from capital to help support this project.
And we'll be talking about the utilities budget soon. We'll be setting a meeting for this pretty promptly.
Oh, boy.
End of the meeting. Yep. All right, then. We're ready for a motion. Are there any other questions from anybody? Anybody on the board? Anybody who's in attendance? All right. We're ready for motion, please.
To award a contract to Kingsbury Companies of Waitsfield, Vermont in the amount of $152,200 to complete repairs to the Brattleboro outfall pipe.
Any further questions or comments? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Anybody opposed or abstaining? That carries 5-0. Thank you. Next item on the agenda is the Fire Department Communications Equipment Grant.
If you recall, back in September, we were here to ask for your approval to submit a grant to the Assistance to Firefighters grant to replace all of our air packs as well as all of our portable radios. Since then, actually within the last 3 weeks, Homeland Security has come out with a funding opportunity for communications equipment. What I would like to do with your permission is to submit to this funding source, again for the same request to replace all of our portable radios, the Mayday recorder that was to go in central dispatch, as well as to replace 40 of our voice pagers. The opportunity that I see here is twofold. One is it doubles our chances of possibly getting some of this funding for the communications equipment. I anticipate hearing well in advance of the FEMA grant about this grant here. Plus the other advantage is that this is 100% funded, where the FEMA grant has a match, so it would lower our responsibility, if you will, to the FEMA grant if we're awarded this one. And then if we're awarded everything in the FEMA grant, I would just turn down the communications equipment in that grant. So I would ask that you allow us to apply to this funding source in the amount of $72,232.
So does one negate the other one, or I didn't quite follow that, so I just wanted to make sure I'm on the right page.
No, what the fire department's seeking to do is to make a request to two different entities.
Once. Right.
So in the event that they are awarded this particular grant, that would be a grant that they would receive 100% funding for and wouldn't require any match. That would allow them to turn down that portion of the second grant, which would require a match.
Okay. So, but we could get it. We could.
If it's granted,
we could win both of them.
Right, but we would need both,
for
the radios.
Okay, just wanted to. Yeah. Yeah.
And what's the turnaround time between submitting the application and hearing back?
On this one?
On this one.
Probably within a month or a little bit over.
So considerably which will be quicker.
Yeah.
Considerably quicker,
gotcha.
Yes. I'm still very optimistic about the FEMA grant, only because we haven't got our no thank you letter yet. So that pretty much keeps us, we're still in the running for that funding also.
And the FEMA grant would allow us to replace all of the air packs at once, which at
right.
this point is a capital item that would have to be spread out over a period of years.
Right. Yeah.
And we agree to borrow that money over time rather than doing the entire hit this year?
Yes.
That was over 5 years.
Right.
Yeah.
All right. So we're still in the running.
So we're
for
still
that.
In the
yes.
running on that. Yeah. Good.
I guess when I heard this item was going to be on the agenda, I inquired of Patrick whether this related in any way to the communications equipment grant that we'd been looking at that would make a difference as to whether the repeater maybe was going to be at the top of Harris Hill or was going to be up at SIT.
Right.
And maybe you can just talk to us also about that issue, and that may be more for Gene than for you, but I don't know.
I think Gene is going to apply for this to pick up the rest of that equipment.
If take the next item up and do combine.
Just so we understand the relationship between them, and then
The
you
police
could.
Department is also going to be applying for the same exact grant. We're waiting for cost estimates from a radio tech, so we know exactly how much we're going to put in for that. So you'll be seeing a memo similar to this very shortly before the next select board meeting. What we're going to be applying for is the last grant that the communication grant that we just went through. We were tentatively, we've been told, or preliminarily told, that we were not awarded the repeater part of that project. We put in for repeaters, a digital voter repeating system, as well as portable and mobile radios. Tentatively, we've just been told we've been awarded nearly $96,000 for portable radios and mobile radios, but not the digital repeater system. So now that this second grant opportunity is coming along, what we would like to do is just focus on those digital repeater system for our radios. So once that equipment is moved, we can upgrade it.
So just so people out there in TV land know, does that have anything to do with the tower on Wantastiket? And because you need to have 3 points of
what? What the project is that equipment is going to be moved.
Right.
We have we're going to plan B to use a used repeater and move that repeater and replace it somewhere else. And then this grant that we're going to be applying for, if awarded, will replace that equipment to upgrade our radio system so it's as good as the fire department.
So people will still know that, like, the hospital may have, now would there be a repeater at the hospital, or is that their main? I'm still trying to figure all this stuff out, too.
And we are, too.
I know.
Joe and Bruce are the only ones.
I know. The only ones that don't.
The hospital will be the main point.
It's the main point of 3 point. Right.
Yes. And that project's still moving along very nicely. Matter of fact, Bruce ordered some equipment today to get things moving forward.
So that we're clear, when we approved either last meeting or the meeting before, the spending in the interim, and then included an article on the warning to reimburse from the fund balance, we approved two alternate options for where the, I guess, repeater would be placed, and it was either at SIT or at Harris Hill, depending on which equipment.
Right.
Is that, I mean, or
well, that's
very close.
Repeater.
It's the police department equipment and not the fire department.
Right, I understand that.
So it's limited only to police that had a plan A and a plan B. The two alternate sites for the police department, one, if they were to get the voting repeater system from the last grant application that they had gone through, that would have allowed them to enjoy the same level of communications as the fire department and to be situated at the hospital. That didn't happen. And as a result, we've got a backup plan which places used equipment atop Harris Hill. So that's the plan we're going with today for the police department. They will be located at SIT, at Pleasant Valley, and at Harris Hill. And if in fact we, you know, what we recognize is that there's a real opportunity to bring the police department communication system on par and actually work in close coordination with the fire department, but we need to get a hold of this voting repeater system. Mm-hmm. That comes at a cost, and so there will be a future grant application available for upgrades to the police communication system. Incidentally, I had a recent conversation with some folks up in, I think it's Montpelier, Waterbury, with the state police, just to confirm with them that they were open to receiving applications from the fire department and from the police department and wouldn't see those as being in competition with each other. And they were perfectly supportive of an application for the fire department and a separate application for the police department. And in fact, the future grant application that we're looking forward to seeing from Gene Wren should indicate how that particular proposal is going to bring the police department communications on par with fire.
If we get money to get the repeater from a repeater to upgrade the police equipment, would we then be moving from Harris Hill over to the hospital?
We would put a new repeater on the hospital, that's correct.
And we wouldn't be using Harris Hill anymore?
That's correct.
Okay.
We'd leave it as a backup.
If the timing is right because of the quick turnaround with this grant, we may not even have to go to Harris Hill if they're awarded that that grant?
It just seems like in the last, there's been a lot of grants and a lot of, I'm trying to keep up with which one we get and which one we don't get.
The state is really pushing for improved communications right now, and they're making a significant amount of financial resources available to communities, and they're asking for us to inventory all of our equipment in terms of, you know, radios, repeaters, the whole kit and caboodle, and they're really making decisions at that level as to how to protect the state. Mm-hmm.
So I think that we've now discussed both E and F on the agenda. Is that fair to say?
I think so.
So then we're ready for the motion under E.
I move we approve a grant application to the Vermont Division of Emergency Management and Homeland Security in the amount of $72,232 to replace all portable radios and pagers and to purchase a Mayday decoder.
Is there any further discussion about that motion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Anybody opposed or abstaining? That carries 5-0. Next item on the agenda is the FY13 financial audit.
Thanks,
hi, John.
Guys.
David, thank you.
Hey, John.
The good stuff, John, right?
Good. Now we're getting into the meat of this. This is the fun stuff.
So included in your packet is the audit report for 2013, and I'm going to just go over some of the highlights from the audit, so I'll be going page by page.
And I actually read it.
Oh,
the
good
whole
job.
Yeah, and I even highlighted some things.
So we'll start on page one. The very bottom of page one is the auditor's opinion on these financial statements, and I'll just read part of the last sentence here. It says, in our opinion, the financial statements referred to above present fairly in all material respects the respective financial position of the governmental activities, the business type activities, each major fund, and the aggregate remaining fund information of the town of Brattleboro, Vermont. So basically, this is what's called an unqualified opinion. There are no qualifiers to it. Everything is good, and this is a good thing to get an unqualified opinion. So moving ahead, page 3 through 7, this is called management's discussion and analysis. And this is something that I prepare relative to the financial statements. It's our perspective on where we are financially. And on page 3, you can see there's a section called financial highlights, and I'll just highlight a couple of those things. You can see in the highlights that there's an increase in the general fund's fund balance of close to $840,000. The bulk of that, $765,000, was due to a transfer from the capital fund. So even though it's a big increase in fund balance, it's associated with a transfer from the capital fund for the most part. You can also see,
John,
that...
Can you just take a moment to explain why that was the case, why we did that? I think it's important for everybody to understand. I know you and I discussed that a little bit. Can you just walk through that?
We discovered a relatively large surplus in the capital fund last year that we felt would be available to fund capital projects. We could have left that surplus in the capital fund and simply not done a transfer from the general fund and just used that surplus in the capital fund. But the way the article was worded and was approved at town meeting, it said it was going to be taken from the unassigned fund balance.
Right.
The general fund is the only fund that has an unassigned fund balance. So what we ended up having to do is to move it from the capital fund to the general fund. And then we committed that portion of the fund balance, and now we're basically using that as the source of the transfer back to the capital fund this year. So it's a complicated kind of shell game, but it was basically based on the language of the article last year at town meeting. Also on page 3, in the financial highlights sections, you can see that the cost of all of the town's programs was almost $19,981,000, so very close to $20 million to fund all of the town's programs, which was a decrease from last year of $389,000, and that decrease is really due to expenditures related to Tropical Storm Irene in 2012, and we didn't really have those expenditures in fiscal 13. So there's other information contained in that, you know, management's discussion and analysis, but...
John, can I ask just one thing about... I don't understand that. I don't understand the 19 million, and maybe I... Can I ask?
Sure.
How, where does that figure come from?
The operating and utilities and parking.
So it's everything added together. Okay, I just wanted to make sure that's how it...
It's a great question.
Yeah.
That's how we got to that.
Okay. Because I read it and I'm thinking,
I thought it was 60.
So, no. And then it's everything added together.
Yeah. Okay, good. Then let's move on.
I'm sorry I did this, John. I really am.
I'm glad you are.
Because I've got another one here for you.
I'm glad you did, John. Page 11. This is the bottom part of the balance sheet for our governmental funds. And you can see under fund equity, this is where we show our fund balance. And you can see the general fund, the first column there, the last line, shows an unassigned fund balance of $1,712,000 for the general fund. That's our unassigned fund balance as of the end of last year. You can also see that the capital fund, the third fund over, had a fairly large assigned fund balance, and that's assigned to capital projects, even after the transfer to the general fund. So even after that transfer, the capital fund still had a fairly large assigned fund balance there. We did have a lot of projects that we hadn't done yet, and that's why that balance is as large as it is, because it's there to fund those projects in the future.
And it would probably be fair to say that we borrowed a lot of money to begin the police firework, but it's not shown here, but next year's audited financials will probably have a big pot of money from having borrowed both the first and the second tier of the money for the police fire.
Yes. Well, we won't have the second tier until July of 2015.
So it'll be just beyond.
Right.
Before you go any further, can I just go back to... I just want to highlight something on page 7.
Yep.
That I just found was very interesting, and it was about... And it starts on, I guess it's the third paragraph down, in fiscal year 2014. And I don't know if you want me to read the whole thing, but maybe I will read it. In fiscal year 2014, 55% of the property taxes billed by the town of Brattleboro will be used to fund public education. The high cost of education results in pressures being placed on the municipal budget in order to keep property taxes at an affordable level. The impact of this recession, high fuel prices, low growth within the town, coupled with the desire to have little or no increase in the municipal property tax rate, all contribute to create budgetary pressures in fiscal year 2014. I just thought that was...
Hear, hear.
Who wrote those prose?
I thought that was very, very interesting.
Did you write that?
I did.
John wrote that.
Oh, you wrote that?
I did.
You like that, huh?
That was very good.
Thank you.
Well, because I thought this all came from budget and...
No. This section I write.
Is you?
Yeah.
Very, very, very nice.
John, okay. You might want to remind the board how long you've been doing that and how long the town of Brattleboro has been doing that.
The management discussion and analysis?
Mm-hmm.
Well, I know John Leisenring had been doing it. I changed the format a bit, but we have been doing it for several years, and John had been doing it. So I think when he arrived, that's probably when we began doing it.
I like it.
Good. Okay. All right. Well, thank you, John.
Well, I just wanted to pat you on the back. I didn't know you did.
Okay, moving ahead then, page 13 and 14, what do we have here? This shows the revenues and expenditures of our governmental funds. Total revenues for all of our governmental funds were just under $15.9 million, and total expenditures were close to $15.7 million. The fund balance for all governmental funds was just over $8.2 million. And you can see we have the general fund, we have our development funds, capital project funds, and other governmental funds. And we'll go over those in a few minutes just so you can see how many funds we actually have in the town. Other governmental, capital, and development are a combination of several other funds that are consolidated and shown here in a consolidated format. But there's a lot of funds out there.
You are saying funds, right? Not fun.
I am saying funds. Okay. And let's see, page 16 and 17. This shows our budgetary performance for the year. And, okay, so general fund revenues, including transfers, were approximately $812,000 better than budget. And expenditures, including transfers out, were approximately $28,000 under budget. So on the expenditure side, we were very close to what we had budgeted. On the revenue side, we were quite a bit above where we were budgeted. And again, that's as a result of the capital transfer, the $765,000 transfer. So for the most part, without that transfer, we would have been very close to our budget this year in fiscal 13. And is there anything else there?
But I mean, the transfer was contemplated, so essentially our performance in the last fiscal year was exactly as budgeted.
We were a little bit under budget, right. But, you know, very, very insignificantly.
Right. It was about 76,000 once you removed the 765,000. Right.
Yeah.
765 the select board voted on last year to do, and then town meeting voted.
Right. Right. So you can see there's some large variances. Employee benefits is one. Police department is one, and transfers in. And again, the transfers in is the capital transfer. So those are the biggest variances that we're showing here during the year. Otherwise, fairly close to what we had budgeted. Page 19, these show the operating revenues and expenditures of our utility, our proprietary funds. The utility fund and the parking fund. And you can see that the utilities fund had revenues, including the interest income, of $4,790,000. And that's a combination of the $4,769 at the top, and then if you drop down to under non-operating revenues, you'll see $20,611. Add the two together. So these are broken out a little differently into operating and non-operating revenues. But when we look at the fund as a whole, we want to look at the total. So just over $4,224,000 in expenditures, including the interest and transfers out, producing a surplus of $566,000 in the utility fund. So a fairly healthy surplus. And again, this surplus is an attempt to, again, start building our cash reserves because we know we're going to be having some fairly large bond payments coming due in the future for the wastewater project. The parking fund had revenues of $846,000 and expenditures of $810,000, producing a surplus of $36,000. So our parking fund generally comes in a little bit under budget, you know, produces a small surplus every year, which is a good thing. And it basically performed as it's performed in the past, this past fiscal year.
John, the wastewater treatment plant bond is done in what? In 2030, something like that?
It's a 20-year, there are several different pieces of that bond. Most of them are 20-year payment schedules. Some have not begun yet.
Okay.
Some have begun, but there are some that are still, you know, won't begin until next year. Okay, well, I'm going to skip all the way now to page 41. And page 41, this shows our development fund, and you can see all the pieces of our development fund. We have a disaster relief fund. We have a rental housing fund. We have a small business assistance program fund. We have the UDAG Holstein Fund. We have the VCDP funds. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 different funds that
just
make up our development
fund.
Do you
mind saying what those acronyms stand for? UDAG and VCDP?
That's Department of Agriculture, U.S. Department of Agriculture. And what happened there, what happened with this fund, and you can see it has a fairly large investment of $1.7 million. We got a couple grants from UDAG and from VCDP that were loaned to the Holstein Association. The grants came to the town as grants to the town from Department of Agriculture and from VCDP with the condition that the town would reloan those funds to Holstein when they were building their facility. When they sold that facility to Marlboro College, they were required to repay the town those loans. And they gave the town a zero coupon bond at that time, which was worth about $500,000 and matured in, I think it was 20, 25 years. And we have been holding on to that bond, and when it matures, it'll be worth about $2.3 million, which was the value of the loan.
As the money will belong to whom will the money belong?
Well, it was granted to the town.
It was a grant?
It was a grant from Department of Agriculture and VCDP, granted to the town with the condition that it loan the funds to Holstein.
So once that obligation has been met, which we have,
I believe it's the town's.
And now the money comes back. Well, can we get it early? No, huh?
I think VCDP, what does the VCDP stand for?
Vermont Community
Development
Program.
That's
simple. Pat, you were going to say something.
Yeah, I was just going to say that I have not really done all the research, but I have reason to believe that the UDAG funds would likely stay in something like the development fund and be used for loans.
Right.
Rather, yeah, I mean, it wouldn't necessarily fall to the general
right.
fund or something really,
right.
really,
really cool.
Like that.
really cool.
So.
No. We can only hope and pray.
Right. So that's our development fund. That's the composition of our development fund. If you turn to page 43, you can see the these are the first six funds that make up our other governmental funds. We have a grants fund, community restorative justice, public transportation, Tropical Storm Irene, Union Station, agricultural land preservation. And it goes on to the next page. Recreation programs, a reappraisal reserve, records restoration, skating rink improvements, tree program. And we have two very small funds that are just kind of consolidated there in other funds. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12 different funds here that make up our other governmental funds.
The Union Station project is still...
Yeah, there's a very small balance
right.
in that fund.
Right.
And, you know, that probably will be utilized this year, and that fund will then be closed. Then we have on page 47, these are our capital funds. And we have our capital projects fund, which is the largest of these funds. We have our West River Park Fund, and we have the Skateboard Park Fund. These three funds make up our capital fund, and you can see where the assigned fund balance that we talked about a little earlier, the $1,647,000, that's the combined assigned fund balance from all three funds. And so that that is what's on those pages. And then pages 24 through 40, there's a whole lot of information on these pages that make up the notes to the financial statements. And they include a whole bunch of information on financial topics, including accounting policies, investments, capital assets, pensions, debt, leases. So there's a whole variety of additional supplemental information contained in those notes. And that's really kind of a real brief summary and overview of the audit for 2013. Questions?
Questions from anybody on the board or anybody who's in attendance? John, that was a way helpful presentation. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. And good work.
Thank you.
Yeah, getting an unqualified report.
Yep. Work. Yeah. Great.
Next matter on the agenda is business license fines. Russell, you've been here for a while. I wondered why.
I'll pop it. I'm going to go, Jan.
Yep. I just noticed my name wasn't on there.
Thank you.
I checked.
We got to pump up the fine.
I always forget it. It's terrible.
Business license runs from January 1st to January 1st. We send out reminders in November, December, and January. Start charging penalties after January 1st. By the town ordinance, a fine can be levied once 30 days has passed since the due date of any license in the town. There has been no attempt to fine people in the past. Lists have been made of unpaid licenses, but to this point, there has never been the decision made to issue fines. So we're looking for some guidance here. To someone who has not taken out their $50 license, there is now $25 in penalties and $100 fine, $175.
I understand that there's a question whether we followed through and collected the money last year, so I don't know if that's a topic for discussion now or at another time. But what's the request at this point?
Well, I think out of fairness to the 880 or so businesses that take out, the main motivation for compiling this list is the respect for the licenses that have been taken out. I think there is some room in the ordinance for reducing the fine. There's some default terminology that I don't quite understand, that is 1.5 times the license instead of twice the license. But we're looking for some opinion from the select board.
Well,
there are about 50 outstanding.
How long is this? How long have we had the business license program?
4 years.
Four. So that's.
The first 2 years were pretty chaotic. Nobody ever thought about finding anybody.
I know they were. But, you know,
last year we made a list and it didn't proceed. This year we were more organized in the notifications and the penalties are automatic when the license is taken out on the website.
It has no bite unless it has bite. So. Really, I mean, it's just useless paperwork.
Well said. So, Patrick, can you speak at all to what happened last year? Do you have any more information?
Honestly, David, I don't have a whole heck of a lot of additional information. I recognize that last year would have been the first year for which there was a ordinance that would have supported the putting in place a penalty. I also know that never was brought to the board. And so this will be the first time that this has happened. There is a very clear ordinance in place in Chapter 11 that supports this. And as the board may recognize, there are a variety of different municipal functions for which fines are imposed, and we don't necessarily bring those to the board. An example might be if your water bill's late or something along these lines. But in an effort to really help us to establish a clear procedure, we thought it was worthwhile to bring it to the board and to confirm your position that applying the ordinance to the business license is just. And I think Russell's made a good argument that so much participation has taken place, it's really unfair at this point in time to allow known businesses to go on without having obtained a business license and paid the penalty.
I agree.
We can't claim that every letter reached its objective, but whenever something came back, we tried to find a better address. Whenever possible, we've used email. There have been some site visits, some walks into stores in Main Street. So we've done our best to contact everyone.
Oh, some of these businesses, we clearly know who they are and where they are. You know, like the bank.
Like TV Bank.
Kate, you're going to
Do you have something?
I just want to know, what happens if they never pay it? Like, we don't, do we go...
Well, so far, nothing has happened.
Okay, so it's really now. The next step. Really nothing.
At this point in time, with the penalties and fines imposed, as Russell has indicated, they would finally be substantial enough such that they could be transferred to small claims court.
Right.
So, at their present rate, it really wouldn't make sense, but once you're up over, I think Bob Fisher's told me once it's up over $50 or $60, then it's potentially cost effective.
Or we could send those new police officers in.
Well, you know,
good looking bunch.
We gotta have something to back it up. I mean, I love the grace period.
Yeah, I'm just questioning. I read this and I'm not sure, but I'm wondering. I mean, what I'm thinking is maybe for all these people that all these businesses that haven't paid to send them another notice saying you now owe $75 because there's a $25. What is it?
They've already
late filing penalty. That
was their third notice.
Oh, that was the third notice.
Notice was a reminder. Second right. notice was a reminder. Third notice was a reminder. Also saying it's a penalty.
Okay, and you haven't heard from any of them. That went out January 16th?
We have heard from people each time we send out notices, but there are still about 47 left.
Okay. So now it's time for the $100.
Seems
he
so.
Needs direction.
Okay. So, yeah.
Well, I'm certainly in favor of sending out notice that effective what's today, February 4th?
Yep.
Mm-hmm. At March 1st it's gonna be $175. And that if they don't pay the $75 by then it's $175 and then we'll deal with collection mechanisms after. But I mean if the ordinance is clear, I mean unless we're gonna impose the $100 penalty now, then let's give people notice and do notice that.
They did get notice.
Right.
Four notices.
The $100 penalty was actually reached on February 1st.
Well, we can go after all.
You can make it March 1st, though. It doesn't disturb me.
I mean, the question is whether we want to give notice that we're going to be filing small claims court if these entities don't pay by March 1st. And then whether they're paying the $75 or the $175, I mean, either one is acceptable. So what's
certainly
the board's pleasure?
At the board's pleasure, my thought would be that the folks that are on this list have had numerous opportunities to remedy, and so we're asking to stick to the timelines that are outlined in the ordinance.
So that's what I would like to ask Russell. What would you like us to give you for guidance?
I think we should send in the letter that we have a draft of that says they are now being fined and they have till the end of the month to avoid small claims
court. I'm very happy with that.
Because there will be additional fees for going to small claims court.
Have there been individuals from businesses who have communicated that it's a hardship, or is it you've sent four notices and you hear absolutely nothing back from the majority?
I think it would be fair to say that most people that say it's a hardship say it while they're paying it.
I see.
I say it every time. Every time I give it to them.
So you simply do not hear from them.
In most cases.
And they may think that there's nothing that's going to come from not talking to the town about it.
And there are, Dara, the office manager, has gone up and down Main Street and visited with business people.
I see. So I think it's time.
It's an ordinance. I mean, it's.
All right, so do we need a formal motion? Or, I mean, I'm not really sure that we do. But if you want a motion.
Following the ordinance.
Yes. So, somebody want to make a motion? Howard?
Just a question. So, this 4 years this has been?
Mm-hmm. It's the fourth year.
And not that I want to kick any hornet's nest, but what is the reasoning behind it? Why did the town start it, and what did the businesses get for it?
Money.
John, were you on the board at the time?
Huh?
Were you on the board at the time, four years ago?
Yes, I was, and I couldn't recall what the
chief rationale was that the emergency services get much better information through the license process.
Yep.
A business gets an exemption of up to $5,000 in assessment value when they take out the license, which is worth about $57.
For the personal properties?
And
could you say that again?
Businesses that take out a license get a $5,000 deduction on their business personal property. account, which is worth about $57.
And it was money. I mean, it was motivated a little bit too by.
Absolutely.
By money, by bringing in more revenue to the town.
Certainly.
So.
It brings in about $45,000.
Right.
Okay. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions? Can't wait. Well, then we're ready for a motion, I guess.
That's the thing. Do we need a motion?
Small businesses.
All right. Sure. No, there's 850 businesses, and we're only asking for people to pay what the ordinance requires that's been in place now for 4 years.
So do we need a motion?
Yeah.
We do?
Yeah, it's right there in the proposed motion paper.
Oh. We don't need one. I know it's there, but do we need one? I mean, because he's acting on an ordinance. It's already an ordinance.
Right. It's true.
So
we are seeking your reaffirmation that we follow this.
Reaffirm.
Oh, so do you? So
would you like a motion?
I'd love one.
I just don't want to set a precedent. Like, do we every time we want to
absolutely not.
We have to say it. That's all I'm worried about. You know what I mean? Like,
right.
This doesn't carry weight until we say it again.
Well, but just to be clear, last year the list was presented, uh-huh. And no action was taken.
Okay. Exactly.
Okay.
So we're establishing the procedure now.
Time to do it.
Yeah. So how...
We're just trying to get us,
how you
get
us off on the right
foot. You want to make a motion?
Yeah, to advise...
No, it's right there.
Oh, where is it?
Under H. I said in the proposed motion.
There you go. To accept the 2014 business license fine list as presented and to direct the assessor's office to impose the late fee of $25 and a separate penalty of $100 for operating a business without a license. You have been solely warned.
Is there any further discussion?
Just want to put out are you giving them a date for when?
No, I think that it'll then be in the ordinary course of town business. If businesses don't respond, then town attorney can file small claims or town can small file.
But they have claims. How long before the $100 kicks in? Are you giving them till? I thought a day was mentioned March 1st or something like that.
No, it's February 1st in the ordinance.
February 1st.
In the ordinance.
Is that correct, Russ?
30 days from the time the license is supposed to be renewed.
Okay.
Any further discussion? Any more questions? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anybody opposed or abstaining? That carries 5-0. Next matter on the agenda. Thanks, Russ, for coming.
Thanks a lot.
Have a good evening. The next matter on the agenda is hiring pause.
Do you want to
take a leave?
Take a pause. Basically, and I think you know everybody who was on the board knows what I'm talking about, and the department heads were there too. You know, during our budget discussions, it sort of became clear that we have to think in advance because there are a lot of decisions that are made that impact long term. So I just wanted to talk about before a position is filled that we have the opportunity just to have a conversation about it. And because once we hire somebody, we don't want to fire or lay them off, so we're putting ourselves in a position where we're just continuing sort of some of the issues that we've been having. That doesn't mean I don't want people to freak out. That doesn't mean we're never hiring new people. I think it's just important that we take a deep breath and just look at what we're doing so we can all better understand it and give us some opportunities to plan better for the future. That's my rationale.
Is there a season when retirements happen or contracts are with the schools, once the budget's passed, everybody gets their contract the next year, and somebody's going to retire, they make that decision at that point. Is there a season like that for? No, it just does whenever it happens.
Individually, whenever they feel like cashing in.
So if somebody's going to retire, they just do it whenever it's convenient for them.
Okay. I mean, there may be individual financial reasons that people are considering.
But it's not because school year begins.
Well, maybe the chiefs can. People retire in your departments just whenever? Yeah.
Well, depends on the starting date and their dates of
hiring. Oh, right.
So. Kate and I have spoken some about this, and logistically, it presents an issue in terms of how the discussions would occur, because I don't know that we can speak about individual positions and whether those individual positions should be filled when somebody retires or moves on to another job in a public session. So this would require, I think, some discussion in executive session about personnel matters to talk about whether any individual position should actually be filled. At least that's the way I understand the types of discussions we'd be having. But I certainly, personally, I'm not opposed to using this as another tool to do year-round budgeting and looking at personnel issues as individual employees leave employment, rather than just looking at these issues at the end of the year in connection with budgets.
Can you say a little more about that, Devin? Why we wouldn't talk about whether to fill a position or not in public session?
I think we can talk about it in public session, but I think that we're talking about specific issues when we talk about hiring pause, about workload, and about whether any specific position is one that should then go to the hiring process. And when we're talking about specific issues about workload and impact on other employees, I wouldn't start that discussion in public session. Because
I
just can't tell I just can't tell where any individual position-related discussion is going to go until we talk about it. And it's not fair to other employees, initially, anyway.
So, could I, and I'm just because you guys are still here, I just, are the chiefs here for listening to that? Do you have any thoughts on this? Because you're the only two department heads. Well, no, excuse me. Yeah. Oh, I didn't see you still here.
I figured out why they were staying about
Items
ago. Because they're all kept sitting here.
I would love to hear what your thoughts are. And
please.
I have some comments on this, just and a little history for the board.
Mm-hmm.
This practice, we did have a practice that the select board reviewed every single position. This was back after 1995, after we had our reduction in force. And what happened is, over time, we actually came to the select board, and I said, you know, I have a highway person, I have a police officer, and we'd like to replace it because of da 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 da. And over some time, the board found that it wasn't that useful, that the practice is more useful in the budget, which you can control. And we did have these discussions in the budget process, and you know the positions that we actually recommended as department heads on how we would make those cuts. And then to take this, you hire the town manager and the department heads to run the divisions, and I think there's a balance here. And I think that needs to be respected. And I'm saying that because the board had the chance and the opportunity, based on the recommendations of these department heads, to make cuts. So I'm wondering, you know, why we would have this additional layer.
Well, can I answer that? My philosophy, and I totally respect what you folks, your opinion on this. I think from my standpoint, you know, we came into the budget in November. Like, literally, it was, you know, you guys got to make a decision in 6 or 8 weeks on where the budget's going. And I think we did the same thing to you folks when we said, hey, tell us who you cut. What do we give you? 2 weeks. So I just feel, from my standpoint, you know, yeah, a board did it in 1995, but I wasn't there. And maybe we'll do it and we'll find out it's not helpful. I just feel, and I don't want to micromanage, just like the last thing. We all have enough stuff to do in our lives to, like, run your departments or run the town. But I think there are other issues, you know, besides just along with the salaries of people, there's all these other issues, which is the health insurance and everything. And I know it would be helpful, you know, for me, from the perspective of really, because it's going to be hard, and we always said this, you know, and even in the next fiscal year. And, you know, I'm hoping that if we do this, we can avoid what we just went through, you know, in 8 weeks. I mean, that's where I'm coming from, just to have a better understanding of, because we don't want to decimate your departments. I mean, I think we learned that, you know, balancing the budget on your backs is not the solution to our problem. I mean, that's what I learned. But I just think it's helpful and instructive to really, you know, have a better understanding of where we're going. And to me, it's almost not about the position and the person. It's about, we're reaching a point where we have to be really creative with what we do. And I'm not saying you're not creative with what you do, you know, but I just feel like from the perspective of being on the board, it's helpful to have an understanding so that we come, you know, we're not doing what we did, and it's not our fault that we did it, what we did, that we had to wait till November, because that's just the reality of the situation we were all in at the time. So, I mean, that's why I come from my thought, and it's not to be disrespectful to you folks, because I don't want to, I mean, I don't have enough time in my day to live my life, let alone I don't want to be micromanaging.
Donna?
So I want to say, I think it's the board's responsibility to do our best thinking about how to be in relationship to the budget in a way that's proactive. I think it is the department head's responsibility and the interim town manager's to push back against our ideas and suggestions in a way that creates that healthy tension so that we can arrive at something that actually makes sense. So I was, having been part of that conversation, it's a really different thing, I think, to suggest simply a pause than it is a hiring freeze. And I also think it's problematic and challenging for the town that the select board members are so transitory in a way, and that, you know, you all have done your work for many years and had different configurations of select boards make all kinds of proposals. But I welcome that feedback. I think we all do. I think it's a really important thing for us to give it our best effort and for you all to say, that makes me a little nervous and here's why. And I think if we can continue that dialogue over the course of the next 12 months, we may find ourselves in a different place next year with the budget.
Donna, you are so good at that. I wouldn't have come anywhere near that. So that's very well played.
Mike, Gene, whoever wants to go first.
If I can, there are some hiring clauses built in. Technically, the department heads don't have the authority to hire and fire. So when someone is fired or hired, we have to go through the town manager anyway to get approval to hire or fire someone. So there are built-in clauses. Some concerns that I would have personally is that we only have opportunities to send officers and staff to specific training certain times of the year. If we get stuck into a hiring pause and miss this window, we're now back almost a full year to get someone into a school. We're down that position for a long extended period of time. And staffing and productivity and effectiveness can greatly suffer, and public safety will suffer.
Mike?
I would agree with everything that Steve and Gene said, and also I feel as though when we do the budget process, which this year was a very healthy process, and it was one of the better ones that I've been in my career, you folks approve a staffing level for the next coming budget year. For us to come in here every time we want to hire somebody and jump through the hoops that we jumped in during the budget season, to me, doesn't make a lot of sense. I think we justified the staff that we carry now. And also, the other thing is, in the fire department's case, if hiring is delayed, that could very well mean a lot of overtime paid out to fill shifts on our part, and it creates an unbalanced, you know, the whole discussion we had during budget season. We're now recreating that situation by even pausing hiring. It's just another thing to consider.
John?
I will not be anywhere near as eloquent as Todd was. I, and believe me, this it's not adversarial. It's not. We, as a select board, have a charge to do. And Mike, thank you for putting it that way. I thought it was a very good communication between all of us during. And the one thing that I think that's going to happen next year that's going to even help us, this board is going to be sitting here next year. And I think I hope. I don't know. Something could happen. I may not be sitting here. But if we are, I think we're going to jump on this a lot quicker. And so that it's not such a burden, you know, and we know what to expect. But it really isn't. And I know when you're talking about budgets and money and personnel and everything, it's a tough road to go down. But, you know, that's what we're supposed to do. And like Donna said, that's what you're supposed to do. You're supposed to kick back. And so I just hope that you know it's all in the betterment of the town. And I can see where Kate's coming from a little bit on this. I don't know what the middle ground is, but I kind of do, and I never want to stay on a fence, but I kind of see both sides of this a little bit. So I just want you to know that, you know, we're here for the betterment of the town.
I'll try.
You go ahead, because I'm ready.
Well, as you all know, I usually change my mind several times.
I don't have a mind to change on this one yet.
That's great.
No,
he's just mindless.
I think right now my thinking is, two thoughts. One is I'd like to for us to take this into consideration and talk about it at the next meeting instead of deciding right now. But the we're going to be looking at how we do business, how the whole town does business, how things operate. That's part of our goal that we've talked about in terms of next year. And it kind of seems like doing a hiring pause now is anticipating that we're going to find things out and not need those people going forward. And I think that maybe it's premature to do it that way. On the other hand, if once you hire somebody, the way it works is that's pretty much it. They're there until they don't want to be there anymore. And it's very difficult to reduce force or change a system that's as big as this and as complex as this. So I'm hesitant to, I just don't understand enough at this point about it. I need more information and a better understanding of what the effects would be. And I certainly hear what the department has just said. It's kind of like I don't really see an argument against it right now. If we had something in mind and we really needed to constrain any additional hiring until we finished the process that was clearly defined at this point, I might feel differently. But right now, it's just leave it alone until somebody convinces me otherwise.
I'm not going to try to convince you otherwise. I'm just going to articulate my position. Last year, one of the steps that we decided to take in order to ensure that we had as much information as possible about the budget and to make sure that we were prepared to address whether our level of service was appropriately corresponding to our ability to pay, was to do these department reviews. And each of the departments, through the department heads, came and presented what they do for work and how the personnel achieve those goals. I don't really see the hiring pause as anything particularly different from the next logical step in that process. We looked at what the departments do and how they do it, and it seems to me that as people retire or decide that they're leaving employment, to have the select board updated and briefed on what those positions entail and exactly why the services need to be provided by hiring a new employee is a perfect next step and a logical extension of that department review as a whole, which is essentially having us understand exactly what's going on in terms of the employees that work for the town and people who do the work for the town. I've presented the two overviews in the last 2 years, and we'll be doing it again this year, of the municipal budget. And what is it, 70-80% of the costs of the town are found in salaries and benefits. And I don't really see this as an issue of delay that's going to prevent people from getting into the academy, or delay that's going to prevent steps being taken from hiring a new firefighter or a new public works employee or any other employee. In any way, I don't think that this is an across the board decision not to hire people.
Right.
I think that as soon as we're aware that somebody's leaving their position, it's not an unreasonable request for the select board to have a relatively quick, it's going to take 20 minutes, a half hour's worth of discussion in executive session in order to understand what that position entails and why it should be filled, and whether there's any reasonable basis for determining that level of service might change. And I am willing to be as flexible as possible and as available as possible in order to make sure that all of us know as much as we possibly can about the way departments are operating, in order to make sure that we're continuing to do our due diligence in delivering services as efficiently as possible. Because next year, we're not going to have the same availability probably of surplus, and we're going to have $500,000 more in police fire, and we're going to be looking again at a significant increase. And I want to continue doing the work over the course of the entire year. So I'm in favor of doing this. Maybe we don't like the word hiring pause, because it's really just a matter of review of open positions in order to make sure that they should be filled. And I'm not looking to micromanage. I just want the information in hand. So I think we should put it off till next meeting and decide. But that's where I'm at.
Yeah, that's good articulation.
Can I say one last thing?
Yeah, please.
I guess I'm sitting with, most of my adult life having been more on the staff end and not the board end of things, and certainly understanding how it makes sense to put the power into the hands of the people who are best positioned to make the decisions. And I don't think there's any part of the select board that is desirous of stepping in inappropriately. And so I just wanted to say that. I think it's understandable, the concerns, and I think if we find ourselves in conversation at the next meeting and decide to give this a try, we would do that with a lot of input about how it's working along the way. And we would have to do our end of making sure that that was timely and well thought out and with a lot of input from each of you. So.
And hopefully we'll find after 2 or 3 or 6 months that it isn't making any difference and we should stop, just like happened 13 years ago or 18 years ago, whatever it was. Mm-hmm. But at least I'm in favor of giving it a try. Mm-hmm. So any more discussion about that one?
Do we move to table it?
No, it wasn't a motion. It was just a topic for discussion at this point. So the next matter on the agenda is committee appointments. Rosamund Blake is putting her name forward for Tree Advisory Committee, and Summer Birch is putting their name forward for Tree Advisory Committee. No, Senior Solutions Board. So, I move that we appoint Rosamund Blake to the Tree Advisory Committee and Summer Birch to the Senior Solutions Board. Is there any discussion?
Summer Birch should be on the Tree Advisory
Committee. Well, let's all be respectful. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anybody opposed or abstaining? That carries 4-0. And then the only remaining matters on the agenda is to set the informational town meeting and to set the utilities budget meeting. The informational town meeting, I believe, is generally the week before town meeting, on like Tuesday, Wednesday, or Thursday. So Is there any particular proposal, Patrick, for the date of the informational town meeting?
Informational town meeting, March 12th, 6 p.m. at the Academy School.
All right. Anybody want to make a motion to hold informational town meeting Wednesday, March 12th at 6 p.m. at the Academy School?
That's on a Wednesday, right?
Yeah.
Yes.
That's usually, it's always usually on a Wednesday.
So does somebody want to make that motion?
Go ahead, Kate.
I'll move that we hold the informational town meeting on Wednesday, March 12th at 6 p.m. at Academy School.
Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anybody opposed or abstaining? That carries 4-0. See, Dave's missing all the interesting business. He went to the bathroom, you know. And then the last item, which is moved up from way earlier in the agenda, is to set a meeting on the utilities budget. I don't think we need to convene as utility or water and sewer commissioners to make this decision, but I think it's probably an hour meeting for starters, 7:30 to 8:30 in the morning. So I think it doesn't have to be tomorrow. I understand you have to pull out at night. It doesn't have to be tomorrow. You know,
hear the tone. That's a 9 o'clock tone. Right.
So, come on, let me be friendly. So I hope we can do it next week. Is there a reason we can't do it next week?
No.
All right, so absolutely. Would everybody please just let Jan know by Thursday their availability at 7:30 to 8:30 for any morning next week?
You know me, Jan.
So let me know by tomorrow.
Yeah.
No, 2 days.
I was going to, because tomorrow is the weather's bad, so I wanted to give. You have a cold?
You have a cold.
You have a cold.
You.
Hope you feel better.
Yes, sir. I
okay.
do.
All right. So we're going to set a utilities meeting for 7:30 someday next week, and it'll be an hour-long meeting. Please tell Jan if you're not available some morning by Thursday, and she'll notice the meeting.
Poor woman should be in bed.
All right. I'll read announcements. I'll read the calendar.
Atta boy.
February 6, 2014, Police Fire Facility Billing Committee is in the Hannah Cosman meeting room at 4 o'clock. The next day, Friday, February 7, 4 to 5:30 p.m., Finance Committee in the Hannah Cosman meeting room. Monday, February 10, 6 to 9, Planning Commission Select Board meeting room. 6 to 7:30, same night, Rex and Parks Board meeting in the Gibson-Aiken Center. Tuesday, February 11, 2014, 4 o'clock to 5:30, Arts Committee at the Hannah Cosman Meeting Room. 7 to 9 p.m., Tree Advisory Committee at the Hannah Cosman Meeting Room. Thursday, February 13, 4 p.m. to 5:30 p.m., Police Fire Facility Committee, Hannah Cosman Meeting Room. Friday, February 14, ADA Advisory Committee at the Marlboro College Graduate Center VCIL Conference Room. Finance Committee at 4 o'clock to 5:30 in the Hannah Cosman Meeting Room. Monday, February 17, closed. Tuesday, February 18, Select Board Meeting, 6:15 to 8:15, here. Motion to adjourn.
I move to adjourn.
We have a motion to adjourn. Is there any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anybody opposed or abstaining? That carries 5-0. Thank you, BCTV. Thank you, members of the press. Thank you, everybody who was in attendance. Thank you, Select Board members.
You didn't even give us a chance.
Thank you, ASL interpreters.
Signatures before you.
So, David, I'm refusing to sign the highway model.